Welcome to the Honest Media. Today is February 9th, 2017, and we are broadcasting with all new equipment here at KGPT 26. It's an exciting day at the station, at the studio, and I'm excited to get started. So what I want to do is I'm going to start with a story, and before I get in too far into the story, I've got a couple definitions I want to read you. And this is from Politico, of all people, the people who emailed back and forth with Hillary Clinton's campaign saying, because I'm such a hack, I'm going to let you tell me if my story is good enough to air. And so this is just the headline. We'll start with the headline and then we'll go from there. Republicans fear for their safety as Obamacare protests grow. And you know, there was a guy, there was an old dead Greek guy, Socrates, a couple thousand years ago, who told us the beginning of wisdom is the definition of terms. And so they're calling this a protest. People are afraid for their lives, for their well-being, because of what they call a protest. So let's just go to the Webster definition of protest, shall we? A solemn declaration of opinion, and usually of dissent, such as a sworn declaration that the payment of a note or bill has been refused, and that all responsible signers or debtors are liable for resulting loss or damage, or a declaration made especially before or while paying that a tax is illegal and that a payment is not voluntary. 2, the act of objecting or a gesture of disapproval, resigned in protest, especially a usually organized public demonstration of disapproval. 3, a complaint, objection, or display of unwillingness, usually to an idea or course of action. 4, an objection made to an official or governing body of a sport. So that is the Webster definition of a protest. I don't think people would be fearing for their lives, for their physical well-being under a protest. Let's try riot, just for kicks and grins. Definition of riot. Public violence, tumult, or disorder. A violent public disorder, specifically a tumultuous disturbance of the public peace by three or more persons assembled together and acting with common intent. That sounds a little more familiar to what we see. We see these people take to the streets, burning trash cans, setting fires, doing horrible things to their communities. Just look at Berkeley a couple weeks ago. That's exactly what we saw. But one more definition. Terrorism. The systematic use of terror, especially as a means of coercion. So that sounds also a little bit like we're hitting the nail on the head. These people want President Trump to step down. They want him to get a different Secretary of Education. They want all these different things. So what do? They burn down their cities. They burn down their schools. They burn down the Starbucks that wants to hire 10,000 refugees. So that is the definitions that we're operating with as we read this fake news article from Politico. Republicans fear for their safety as Obamacare protests grow. House Republicans, during a closed-door meeting Tuesday, discussed how to protect themselves and their staffs from protesters storming town halls and offices in opposition to repealing Obamacare, sources in the room told Politico. House GOP Conference Chairwoman Kathy McMorris Rogers invited Representative David Reichert, former county sheriff, to present lawmakers with protective measures they should have in place. Among the suggestions, having a physical exit strategy at town halls or a back door in congressional offices to slip out of in case demonstrations turn violent. Remember, these are supposed to be protests. Protests had nothing to do with violence in the definition. Riot did. Terrorism did. But these are supposed to be protests that just accidentally turn violent. Another preventative measure. Having local police monitor town halls, replacing any glass office door entrances with heavy doors and deadbolts, and setting up intercoms to ensure those entering congressional offices are there for appointments, not to cause chaos. Again, chaotic protests. You know, I've been to a few protests in my day. We didn't burn things. We didn't make people fear for their safety. That wasn't what we were there to do. So when we call these things protests, it's a lie. It's fake news. That's all there is to say about it. And it's rather sickening that Politico, which has been outed as a totally Democrat-controlled, Democrat-run organization, is still buying into this. It's sad and it's sickening. Asked about the intensity of the protest during a news conference after the meeting, Paul Ryan said he hopes demonstrations remain nonviolent. To which I say, Paul Ryan, are you asleep? What are you doing? How is this guy not aware of everything happening? Peaceful protests are something we honor in this country, he said. I just hope people keep it peaceful. Democrats, meanwhile, dismissed Republican security ramp up as an attempt to shield themselves from criticism. I think what you're seeing is Republicans try to use security to try to hide themselves from their constituents because they have no plan for replacement and very little support of Donald Trump. Which is just an outright lie. CNN reports there's little support. Anybody else, Gallup, public policy polling, anybody else you ask, yeah, he's a very popular president. In fact, the majority of this country supports his immigration ban, as they like to call it, the Muslim ban, as they like to lie about it. In fact, only 35% of the country doesn't approve the ban, meaning that's a heck of a lot of Democrats, people on the left side of the spectrum, who agree with the president or at least want to let him have his chance to run the country the way he promised he would, suggesting it's only a radical margin of people who really want to oppose Trump in every single way possible. And while we're talking about fake news, from The Federalist, which is a great organization, I suggest you read their articles, subscribe to them in whatever form you receive your news. 16 fake news stories reporters have run since Trump won. Since at least Donald Trump's election, our media have been in the grip of an astonishing self-inflicted crisis. Despite Trump's constant railing against the American press, there is no greater enemy of the American media than the American media. They did this to themselves. So we'll just talk about a few of these. Remember, there are 16 stories here, and I could have found more. I'm jealous this guy got to the article before I did, because I could have found 200 stories that the mainstream media has run that turned out to be proven false. Again, they never post a retraction, they never admit their mistake, but the story is proven false, and they just march right along on to the next fake news controversy. Early November, this was right after his massive win. And we'll go back to this in the next segment, but I want to give you a few of these. We got to take a break, then we'll be right back to give you more. Early November, spike in transgender suicide rates. After Trump's electoral victory on November 8th, rumors began circulating that multiple transgender teenagers had killed themselves in response to the election results. There was no basis for these rumors. Nobody was able to confirm them at the time, and nobody has been able to confirm them in the 3 months since Trump was elected. Nevertheless, the claim spread far and wide. The Guardian writer and editor-at-large of Out, Zach Stafford, tweeted the rumor, which was tweeted more than 13,000 times before he deleted it. He later posted a tweet explaining why he deleted his original viral tweet. His explanatory tweet was shared a total of 7 times. Meanwhile, Pink News writer Dominic Preston wrote a report on the rumors, which garnered more than 12,000 shares on Facebook. And Mike Matthew Rodriguez wrote about the unsubstantiated allegations. His article was shared more than 55,000 times on Facebook. Urban legend debunker website Snopes wrote a report about the rumors, and this is Snopes. We've railed on Snopes on this program before. Snopes listed them as unconfirmed rather than false. So there's no proof of this. Snopes says unconfirmed. Ridiculous. All right, we're going to take a break. When we get back, we've got November 22nd, the tri-state election hacking conspiracy theory. December 1st, the 27-cent foreclosure. January 20th, Nancy Sinatra complains about the inaugural ball. All fake news. We'll get to it right after the break. Thank you for watching The Honest Media. I'm Tom Kapp. Welcome back to The Honest Media. I'm Tom Pappert, your host, and we're talking about 16 fake news stories that have been selected by The Federalist and exposed. That the media writes them, they rarely retract them, they keep these rumors going, and then when it gets totally exposed as fake news, they move on to the next. And remember, fake news is a term that was recently brought back into the mainstream by BuzzFeed. BuzzFeed, which published the now infamous Russian dossier that turned out to be totally bogus, never retracted it, never admitted it was bogus, and they're actually being sued by one of the companies named in there, a Russian company, for libel, slander. That's what it is when you lie about somebody, put it on your website, talk about it on television. All right, so next one from The Federalist. November 22nd, the tri-state election hacking conspiracy theory. November 22nd, Gabriel Sherman posted a bombshell report on New York Magazine claiming that a group of prominent computer scientists and election liars were demanding a recount in three separate states because of a persuasive evidence that the election results in Wisconsin, Michigan, and Pennsylvania may have been manipulated or hacked. The evidence, well, apparently, in Wisconsin, Clinton received 7% fewer voters in counties that relied on electronic voting machines compared with counties that used optical scanners and paper ballots. The story went viral. It was shared more than 145,000 times on Facebook alone. Sherman shared it on his Twitter feed several times, and people retweeted links to the story nearly 9,000 times. We're talking about 155,000 shares of this fake news story altogether. Politico's Eric Geller shared the story on Twitter, and his tweet was tweeted just under 8,000 times. You see how this is stacking up? This is how they perpetuate their fake news stories. These phony journalists who claim to be the people who control and moderate and curate your news and information, they lie to you, they don't admit it, and they just power through. At one point, however, the damage had already been done. After Nate Silver at 538 explained that it was demographics and not hacking. Nate Silver said, anyone making allegations of a possible massive electoral hack should provide proof, and we can't find any. Additionally, Silver pointed out that New York Magazine's article had misrepresented the argument of one of the computer scientists in question. Nate Silver's post, by the way, shared 380 times. Yeah, so we're talking 160,000 plus shares of the fake news story versus Nate Silver's share or a tweet debunking it 380 times. Fake news is out there, and it's coming from the mainstream. It's not coming from me. It's not coming from InfoWars. It's not coming from Breitbart. December 1st, the 27-cent foreclosure. At Politico, you know, the fake news we were talking about in the last segment, at Politico, on December 1st, Lorianne Wellert published a shocking essay claiming that Trump's pick for Secretary of Treasury, whose last name I still can't say, I'm sorry to tell you, had overseen a company that foreclosed on a 90-year-old woman after a 27-cent payment error. Horrifying, right? Can you imagine that happening to your mother, to your grandmother? 27 cents, she left off the check. They sent another invoice saying you owe us 30 cents. She sent back 3 cents. And so then they foreclose. Now the problem. The central scandalous claims of Wellert's article were simply untrue. The Competitive Enterprise Institute's Ted Frank pointed out the woman in question was never foreclosed on and never lost her home. Moreover, it wasn't even the guy's bank that brought the suit. Some random bank, so they point the finger at Trump's Secretary of Treasury. It's ridiculous. Complete fake news. Somebody with access to Wikipedia and Google could debunk this. And Politico eventually corrected the errors, but the damage, again, was done. The story had been repeated on numerous media outlets, including Huffington Post, shared 25,000 times, the New York Post, Vanity Fair, and others. January 20th, Nancy Sinatra complains about the inaugural ball. On the day of Trump's inauguration, CNN claims Nancy Sinatra, daughter of the legendary Frank Sinatra, Trump danced to My Way as his first dance with Melania as president. CNN said that Nancy Sinatra was not happy with the fact that President and First Lady's inaugural dance would be to the tune of Frank Sinatra's My Way. The problem, Nancy Sinatra never said that. She actually went on Twitter and said, I never said this. CNN, why do you lie? CNN updated the article, but it was already shared thousands and thousands of times. Which brings us up to Also January 20th, the non-existent climate change website purge. I was hoping this one was real, because from my standpoint, climate change may be real, but it's been greatly exaggerated by the quote-unquote climate scientists who build their models with a output in mind. If you put something into the model that isn't necessarily true, you get something out of the model that isn't necessarily true. Also on the day of the inauguration, New York Times writer Coral Davenport published an article on the Times' website whose headline claimed the Trump administration had purged any climate change references from the White House website. Within the article, Davenport acknowledged that the purge, what she also called online deletions, was not unexpected, but rather part of a routine turnover of digital authority between the administrations. So here we have the New York Times, which runs ads. I see it in my Facebook news feed all the time, saying, we are real news. Protect yourself from fake news with the New York Times. We have the New York Times admittedly lying in their headline and then in the body of the article saying, well, it's not actually a purge. It's actually just what all administrations do. You know, they have to completely revamp the website, so some stuff gets removed and then uploaded again. You basically have the New York Times lying to their readers for clickbait so they can get their article shared virally. And you know what? It worked. And it goes on and on and on. January 20th, the great Martin Luther King Jr. bust controversy. They lied and said Trump removed the bust from his office. He never did such a thing. January 20th, Betsy DeVos, grizzly fighter. They say they lie about this poor woman. We're going to talk about her in the next segment. They do all kinds of disgusting things to make this woman sound awful when she's going to save our nation's struggling education system. January 26th, the resignations at the State Department. They weren't resignations. It's whenever the administrations turn over, you hire new people. It happens. January 27th, the photoshopped hands affair. A woman at The Observer, Dana Schwartz, tweeted a screenshot of Trump that, in her eyes, proved that Trump had photoshopped his hands bigger for a White House photograph. The tweet immediately went viral. The conspiracy theory was debunked, but not before it had been shared thousands of times. Meanwhile, Schwartz tweeted that she did not know whether or not the hands were shopped. Her correction tweet was shared a total of 11 times. The Reuters account hoax. The Daily Beast published an article quoting Reuters, saying that the two shooters of the Toronto shooting, mosque shooting, was perpetuated by two white guys who are actually, it's a meme. You say the same guy did every single terrorist attack in the world. It was from a parody Reuters account that in the description of the Twitter account, it said, this is not really affiliated with Reuters. We're fake. It's fun. Leave us alone. And it just goes on and on and on. The travel ban lie. POTUS threatens to invade Mexico, easing the Russian sanctions, renaming Black History Month, the House Representatives' gun control measures. It's time to stop reading fake news, is what the thing is. That's what you want to get from this. You can read everything. This is my philosophy. Read everything. Read CNN. Read MSNBC. Also read Breitbart. Also read InfoWars. Also read the Daily Mail. Read everything. So you're getting all the information, then use your critical thinking abilities, which if you're watching this program, I know you have, to get it, to really synthesize it and get the truth out of it. Because these people are paid for clicks, and they're paid Carlos Slim's blog, formerly known as the New York Times, Jeff Bezos's blog, formerly known as the Washington Post. Their payroll depends on deceiving you to bring down Trump. So have all the information, make your own decisions. We'll be right back after the break. You're watching The Honest Media with Tom Papert. Welcome back to The Honest Media. I'm Tom Papert, your host. And I want to talk to you for just a few minutes about Betsy DeVos. She is the, for some reason that I can't quite figure out, controversial pick of Trump's to run the Department of Education. She's a very intelligent woman. Little known fact, her brother is the guy who started Blackwater, which is a totally misunderstood organization in and of itself. And she's really the best thing that we could do for our children. If you watch Wichita Liberty TV, which airs right here on Channel 26, Great Plains Television, you know how important voucher programs and school choice are. Letting parents choose where their children go to school forces the schools to compete and actually hire teachers who will teach the children, not indoctrinate them or babysit them. It's key. It's integral. That is how we raise people out of poverty, with good quality education. Right now we have education that leaves high school seniors reading at like a fourth grade level. And I hate to tell you folks, it's worse for African Americans. It's worse for Hispanics. It's worse for minorities than it is whites. We have a racist system right now. You want to talk about institutional racism? It's in the Department of Education, because they are failing our inner cities. They are failing minorities all across the United States. So this is from Fox Business on Betsy DeVos. Education Secretary Betsy DeVos on school choice, vouchers, and religion. Vice President Mike Pence on Tuesday broke a 50-50 Senate tie to officially confirm Betsy DeVos as the next Secretary of Education. The vote came after a 24-hour talk-a-thon protest from the Democrats, as senators took turns arguing against Trump's nominee throughout the night and into the morning. With the defection of Republican Senators Lisa Murkowski of Alaska and Susan Collins of Maine, in an historic move, Vice President Mike Pence was the tie-breaking vote in favor of DeVos. And they say Trump's administration hasn't talked much about the direction it wants to go with education, but he talked about it all the time on the campaign trail. He talked about it at the RNC. It's called bringing it back to the parents, bringing it back to the communities, giving people choice. That's what he said numerous times, is what he wants to do. So on school choice, DeVos is a firm believer that a child should not be limited to a school district based on their family's income or zip code, a view in line with comments from the president. She has advocated for a controversial school voucher program in the past, which allocates federal taxpayer dollars to provide children the opportunity to attend private and religious institutions of their choice, allowing a parent to decide where their child goes to school. Controversial, right, guys? That's insane! To let a parent choose where their child spends 8+ hours of their day. Let the education dollars follow each child, instead of forcing the child to follow the dollars. This is pretty straightforward. And it's how you go from a closed system to an open system that encourages innovation. People deserve choices and options. DeVos said that during a speech in March of 2015, Critics view DeVos's position on vouchers as a threat to the nation's public school system. But if you want to look at the nation's public school system, take Wichita, Kansas, for instance. We have continually worsening public schools. I feel horrible for the students going through them now, because when I graduated years ago, it was already hideous, horrific. You spent most of your days being babysat. I did most of my learning in probably the fourth and fifth grade. When I went to college, I was shocked. I was unprepared for some of the more intensive classes because I had no education in high school. Totally worthless waste of time. That is what our students get. And if you want to look at the reading, Bob Weeks, Wichita Liberty TV, does a much better job at this than me. But you can look at the state assessments. You can look at how they manipulate the data to make it sound better than it actually is. How they lie to make it sound like they're not cheating these children out of a quality education, when really they are forcing them into a lifetime of illiteracy, low-paying jobs, and no futures. Betsy DeVos wants to fix that. And so naturally, the left demonizes her. The real racist party, the left, the Democrats, they demonize this poor woman for wanting to fix our nation's education system. Future of charter schools. A big part of DeVos's campaign to promote school choice is expanding the charter school sector. Demand for charter schools, which are publicly funded but privately managed, has been on the rise in recent years, according to Dr. Whitehurst. And I do know that one rule for this school charter school system is, at least in Kansas, the public schools have to approve the creation of a charter school. That's a little bit like McDonald's approving of the construction of a Burger King across the street. You don't see that. I'm hoping Betsy DeVos knows this and we can see a reversal. There are quite a few states that have caps on new charter schools, in spite of the fact that there is considerable unmet demand, which we see by waiting lists for existing charter schools. Should the federal government incentivize states to eliminate the caps, that would, in general, be a good thing. As long as it's the state's choice to accept or deny whatever the incentives are, then why not? So you're going to see this woman, and it's not going away. They're going to continue to demonize this poor woman who only wants to see our public school system fixed so the children are actually taught, so they can have a worthwhile future, so they can move out of the ghettos, go back to the ghettos, and make them into good neighborhoods. That's what this woman wants. That's what Trump wants. The left wants to make it sound like we hate the children. Because anytime something doesn't go their way, they have to say, well, they just hate children. They hate old people. Which brings me to the CNN debate that aired on Tuesday night. Perhaps you saw it. I'm sorry if you did, because CNN is fake news. But it was between one Bernie Sanders and Ted Cruz. And previously, we've railed on Ted Cruz pretty hard. But last night was a beautiful redemption. Ted mopped the floor with Bernie Sanders. They were there to debate the future of Obamacare. That's what they were there to debate. Oh, Bernie, old Bernie, crazy Bernie, barely brought up Obamacare. The only thing he would say is, well, I want a single-payer system. That's not the purpose of the debate, Bernie. Did anybody tell you what you were there to talk about? It was sad. It was pathetic. I mean, Bernie is a guy who voted for Obamacare. Bernie is a guy who said Obamacare was a step in the right direction. And then he wouldn't even debate it because he knew it was so bad. So Ted Cruz was able to completely mop the floor with him. But this is where it gets interesting. This is where it gets interesting. This is from the Gateway Pundit, and I've seen this on social media, I've seen this elsewhere. CNN rigged the Cruz-Sanders debate because there were supposed to be audience questions, right? The audience was supposed to be able to ask truthful, heartfelt questions about what mattered to them about the future of Obamacare. And what you can see, you can pull this up online, they emailed the debate questions to the people who asked them. One woman, an old lady, she had a piece of paper in her hand, and she had it folded in half, right? So you can see, if you zoom in on the picture, it says, your debate question. And it's a Gmail printout that she printed off her copier. And the question that was asked, tell me this sounds like something that this woman came off the top of her head. I have multiple sclerosis but could not afford insurance. Without the treatment or medications I need, I had problems with walking, with my speech, and my vision. When the Affordable Care Act was passed, I moved from our home state of Texas because they refused to expand Medicaid. So it goes on and on and on. Yeah, this is an off-the-cuff question. This isn't something she's reading from a piece of paper. You can look at it on YouTube. You can make your own decision. But CNN, purveyor of fake news, faked a debate question. If not all the debate questions. We'll be right back after the break. I'm Tom Patrick for The Honest Media. Thanks for joining me this week. Welcome back to The Honest Media. I'm Tom Patrick, your host. And last segment I told you about poor Betsy DeVos. Just barely got confirmed. All the woman wants is to fix our failing education system, failing all across the country. Unless you live in the richest neighborhoods, unless you can already afford private school, then it's failing. By the way, she also wants to repeal Common Core. I left that out. Very important. And I told you that the left is going to demonize the right. They're going to demonize DeVos. They're going to demonize Trump. They're going to demonize anybody, right of center, who is trying, actively trying to fix our nation's public school system in whatever way they can. And I have proof. You know, when you make an argument, you should substantiate the claims. Well, that's me right now. Okay, Chicago. This is from the Gateway Pundit. All Chicago public schools send letter home with parents bashing Trump and the GOP governor of the state. Yeah. Many parents are upset, understandably so, after Chicago Public Schools sent home a letter to parents trashing President Trump and Republican Governor Bruce Rauner. Teachers union members are also considering yet another protest. They do this about every 6 months in Chicago. All of the 381,000 students were sent home with the following letter. And I'll just read some excerpts to make your blood boil, and then we'll move on and I'll rant about it. Intense rhetoric between Chicago Democrats and Illinois' Republican governor is nothing new. By the way, they're using the term rhetoric wrong. Anybody who studies communication, rhetoric is all the available means of persuasion. They're using the word wrong. Shows how intelligent the people teaching your children, if you're watching this in Chicago or Illinois, shows how intelligent they are. It's nothing new, but some parents are upset as it is now being played out in a letter sent home between their kids. Chicago Public Schools sent home a letter with all 381,000 students blasting Governor Rauner and ignoring the parents. The Dear Parents letter begins by stating, Governor Bruce Rauner, just like President Trump, has decided to attack those who need the most help. Twice the letter accuses Rauner of cheating children. Once it says the governor stole from kids. The governor goes on to cite Chicago Public Schools CEO Forrest Claypool's often repeated claim that the governor broke a promise by blocking Chicago from receiving $215 million for city schools. One Chicago Public Schools parent who contacted the local television station WGN wrote, "This is so inappropriate. How could he send political propaganda home?" Government watchdog groups questioned the district's decision to use such strong partisan language in the letter sent home with kids. Invoking partisan politics, especially at the national level, is not the most effective way to build trust with parents and students, said Sarah Brune of the Illinois Campaign for Political Reform. And this is a little bit of what the letter itself. Governor Rauner, just like President Trump, has decided to attack those who need the most help. Governor Rauner and President Trump regularly attack Chicago because they hope to score political points. It is shameful. Chicago, by the way, Chicago is a place where you can watch YouTube videos of somebody walking through the street. It's 7 o'clock at night and it sounds like fireworks are going off. It's gunfire. People die in Chicago. It has a murder rate on par with that of Iraq. Chirac. Okay. Most recently, Governor Rauner broke his word by blocking Chicago from receiving $215 million for our schools. That $215 million was supposed to be the first step, just a first step, toward treating your children fairly. That $215 million would have been spent on these children, providing a future for your children. With their fair share of the dollars, Illinois spends on children and the rest of Illinois. This is such a poorly written letter. This is the propaganda they choose to send home. But Governor Rauner broke his word and did not take even that first step. Governor Rauner's decision to spend take $250 million from CPS forces us to make tough choices. You will not like these cuts. This is what we call a persuasion from fear. Fear is a strong motivator. If you say, Governor Rauner is hurting your children, he's taking $250 million away, so they're not going to get an education, then the parents are going to vote him out of office. That is the thought process here. It's basic persuasion, and it's disgusting to see them use children, little children, as political pawns to get the politics they want out there pushed out there. We are now writing to let you know about two of the biggest cuts that Governor Rauner has forced us to make right now. First, we imposed 4 furlough days on all CPS employees. We chose 4 days when students would not be in school. But those 4 days are important for our principals, teachers, and other staff to do their work. Second, we froze more than $50 million of spending by the schools. You should know that the $50 million was not for fancy frills or things that do not matter. Our principals will do their best, but spending cuts hurt. Please understand that this means your principal cannot provide everything he or she knows should be available for your children. There is no way to sugarcoat the rest of this news. If we are not able to win the political battles in Springfield, then we will have to make more cuts. Those cuts will be even more painful. We need not just the $215 million first step that the governor has stolen from your children. We need real change that is fair to your children. We want to be clear. CPS cannot run the school system that your children deserve with the funds we have. Under the law, CPS has used all its taxing power to bring in the most dollars we can. CPS has also borrowed billions of dollars to keep the schools open while the governor and his political friends continue to cheat your children out of their fair share, you notice those words, of the state's education dollars. The only solution will require a new approach. a fair approach to fund education in Chicago. And it goes on for a little bit, attacking the GOP, attacking the poor governor, attacking the president, so on and so forth. Now, something important to know that they conveniently leave out: our public school system in the United States is one of the most expensive in the world. We spend thousands of dollars per pupil. Thousands of dollars per pupil. Now think about it. If you, the parent, had $5,000 a year to spend on your child's education, you would spend that money well. You would make sure your child had the best education he or she could get. You would be talking about charter schools, private schools, religious institutions. You would buy them the latest iPads, the latest textbooks. They'd have a subscription to whatever the kids want to learn about nowadays. They would have everything. You could afford to buy a drone so Junior could learn to fly. But when the government mishandles your money, then they need more, and they need more, and the education gets worse, and it gets worse. And that, again, is what Trump, what the GOP, what Betsy DeVos are all trying to fix. They want to give you, the parent, choice about what your child learns, where your child learns, if they learn in an impoverished inner city school or if they learn at the same school the richest members of your community attend. We'll be right back after the break. I'm Tom Papert for The Honest Media. Welcome back to The Honest Media. I'm Tom Papert, your host, and I've got just a few more things about the Democrat Party and how it's really a failing regional party that I want to share with you. Then we've got some excellent news. There's so much good news about the Trump administration. It's almost nonstop, every single day. You know, he said that we would be winning so much we would get tired of winning. Here we are, just a few weeks in to the glorious Trumpenreich, and I think I'm a little bit tired of winning. I have winning fatigue. Okay, so this is from the New York Post. The Democratic Party has lost its mind and its soul. History was made Tuesday when Vice President Mike Pence cast the tie-breaking vote in the Senate to confirm Betsy DeVos as Secretary of Education. But the necessity of Pence's vote reflected another kind of history, too. The decision by all Senate Democrats to reject DeVos marked a new low for the flailing party. Democrats claim to stand for the poor, immigrants, and non-whites. Yet, given the chance to actually support someone who is dedicated to improving education for all America's children, especially those trapped in failing urban schools, the Dems said no. Hell no. Joined by two Republicans, they stood at the schoolhouse door to block vital change, casting their lot with teachers' unions that fear reform, the way a vampire fears garlic. Throw away all the subtext and the subterfuge. The defense of the rotten status quo is the only explanation for the bid to block DeVos. The teachers' unions pulled the strings, and the political puppets danced to their master's tune. DeVos survived because President Trump is determined to deliver a government that shatters the insiders' perks and privileges and opens the door to new ways of doing things. In education, that means giving more power, the power of school choice, and taking power away from the union establishment. Millions of children, most poor, many black and Latino, are forced to attend failure factories that rob them of America's promise. While the family breakdown is a prime culprit, the social contract requires society to do its best to compensate. And there is no question that charter schools, vouchers, and other experiments offer the best hope for bringing fresh ideas and progress to educational deserts. DeVos, a passionate crusader for excellence in the classroom, is just one of the Trump nominees Democrats tried to block in their insane attempts to destroy his presidency before it even gets started. No president has ever had so few cabinet members confirmed at this late date, just as no other president has been confronted with such open talk of assassination and impeachment, at least this early on. Speaking of which, have you heard a single Democrat decry the talk of assassination? Have you heard a single Democrat denounce the violence carried out by so-called protesters? Remember, we defined these terms earlier. They're rioters bordering on terrorists. The answers are no and no, because Democrats see the riots and threats of violence as legitimate expressions of disapproval and convenient for their purposes. Their contribution to the resistance, as they like to call it, started when 70 Democrats boycotted Trump's inauguration and many senators boycotted the confirmation and hearings. Maybe they'll soon be throwing rocks through windows. And I love the New York Post because they're really zeroing in on a market for people who have a little bit of common sense. Now, they still post some garbage. Everybody posts some garbage. I've posted garbage. InfoWars post garbage. Breitbart post garbage. No media is perfect. But they're getting this exactly right. The people who are meant to be leading our government, Democrats, they've been elected. They're supposed to be working for the people. They're stalling. They're sitting in private and doing nothing. They're egging on rioters. The article goes on that Chuck Schumer, when the Democrats stormed out of Congress because they didn't want to do what Trump wanted to do, he said, "We stand with the people protesting outside." They egg on this idea of a resistance movement as if we're France in the 1940s and Trump has just stormed in from Germany with tanks and doped up infantrymen. They're playing pretend, and it's incredibly dangerous. Psychologists will tell you that if you tell people it's okay to kill the president, which it's not, then a lunatic, somebody who already doesn't have the best mental health, somebody who is already in a compromised position, maybe it's undiagnosed, maybe they're not taking their medicine, who knows? Somebody who is in a compromised position is more likely to try if they see magazines putting a bullseye on Trump's head. If they see people on Twitter saying, "Who's gonna assassinate this curse word, they're more likely to try. If anything happens to Trump or his family, the blame will fall squarely on these people on the left who decide that they're not going to denounce these assassination attempts. They're going to play into this resistance narrative as though we're living under Nazi occupation, as if the last 8 years haven't been bordering on communist occupation. And talking about the resistance movement, now this is for Germany, this is for Berlin, but you have to imagine these statistics carry over. From the Daily Mail, 92% of left-wing activists live with their parents, and 1 in 3 is unemployed. This is a study of Berlin protesters. The bullet points from the Daily Mail. Figures were compiled by the Federal Office of the Protection of the Constitution. Of those arrested for politically motivated offenses, 84% were men. The majority, 72%, were between 18 and 29. Of offenses against a person, this is, you know, like an assault on a human being, 4 out of 5 cases were against police officers. The vast majority of left-wing protesters arrested on suspicion of politically fueled offenses in Berlin are young men who live with their parents, a new report found. The figures, which were published in the daily newspaper Bild, revealed that 873 of the suspects were investigated by authorities between 2003 and 2013. Of these, 84% were men, 72% were aged between 18 and 29. So, we've been talking about education. We've been talking about failing education, letting these poor children down, robbing them of the futures they so richly deserve. And this is a worldwide phenomenon. Germany spends a fortune on its public education system. Anybody in the world can go to Germany and go to college for free there. That's how messed up they are. But what are we doing? We're creating a generation of people. No jobs, no future, living at home, no prospects, no interests other than getting in the streets, yelling, screaming, burning trash cans, assaulting police officers. That is the future that the failing education system has given people, not just in the United States, but across the West, where we think throwing more money at a problem is going to magically fix it. We'll be right back after the break. You're watching The Honest Media with Tom Papert. Thank you for tuning in. Welcome back to The Honest Media. I'm Tom Papert, your host. Now, I've given you a lot to think about. It's not necessarily the best news. It is great news about Betsy DeVos, but we're going to move into immigration because they will tell you, the left, of course, that, well, not all the left. I mean, there are people on the left who are waking up, who are realizing how full of lunacy many on their side are. I'm thinking of Dave Rubin and others who do a great job of being classical liberals, is what they call themselves, or not the regressive left, the progressive left. This is from the Gateway Pundit again. Shock poll. Majority of Europeans want to stop all immigration from Muslim countries. Similar to what Trump did. And you know, they will tell you, the left will tell you, that in the United States we're being bigots. Only in the United States do people want to do this. Only in the United States do people want to have sovereign borders. Only in the United States do people not want to bring in people who may end up being terrorists. Because we can't vet them, because they have no birth certificate, they have no file, they have nothing. They're from places without centralized governments, and they send their worst. So yeah, Europeans want Muslim immigration to stop. A newly released poll shows that the majority of Europeans want immigration from Muslim countries to cease. The study was conducted by the Chatham House before President Trump even signed into effect a travel ban from 7 countries that have strong ties to terrorism. From the Chatham House, the majority of Europeans want a ban on immigration from Muslim-majority countries, a poll has revealed. On average, 55% of people across the 10 European countries surveyed wanted to stop all future immigration from mainly Muslim countries. Only 20% disagreed, while 25% said they did not know. And being brave enough to admit you don't know is good. A ban was supported by 71% of people in Poland, 65% of people in Austria, 53% in Germany, and 51% in Italy. In the UK, 47% supported a ban. In no country did more than 32% of people disagree with the ban. So, you know, it's true. In the United States, they tell us that we are heartless, that we're not Christians. This was sent by the Catholic Association of Colleges. You're not a good Christian if you don't want to bring people in. Never mind the fact that you can actually take care of hundreds of people in the Middle East for the same cost as bringing one person to the United States. Never mind the fact that when you take somebody out of a culture that is just barely out of the Stone Age, you know, they treat their women awful, they don't believe homosexuality is acceptable, they will kill you if you're gay. When you take them out of their culture, which is regressive to say the least, and you just airdrop them into Canada or the United Kingdom or America, and you expect them to somehow understand Lady Gaga? You're asking for bad things to happen. You're asking for tensions to rise. You're asking for violence because they don't understand it. What if you were somehow transplanted into ancient China? How well would you get along there? Another analogy that's used frequently, if you move to Japan today, you don't know the language, you would barely understand the culture, you don't know the norms, you don't know anything about Japan. How long would it take before you really felt Japanese? It would never happen. You would never be Japanese. You would never be able to fully assimilate into their culture. In fact, in Japan, they have public establishments, bars, restaurants, clubs, where they specifically ban the presence of Caucasians. They don't like white people going to their establishments. Nobody is calling on Japan to increase their number of refugees. Nobody is calling Japan racist for disallowing white people from its establishments. I'm not saying I want that here. I think any business that discriminates based on race, color, religion, sexual orientation, whatever, they deserve to go out of business, and the market will more than likely make that happen. But what I'm saying is if you take somebody who is from a culture where if a woman is raped and she can't provide 2 witnesses to say it was not consensual, you can stone her to death. You take that person, you drop them in the United States where we have Britney Spears, Miley Cyrus, Lady Gaga, these women who brag about their sexual exploits the way men used to in the 70s, who dress half naked and go out to dance and shake their stuff during professional football, you're going to have problems. You're going to have major, major problems. They're not going to understand our culture. They're not going to understand our values. They're not going to understand why it's acceptable for women to walk around in virtually nothing here, because they come from what is a legitimate rape culture. We're going to drop them into a culture where we have specifically rid ourselves of rapists and undesirables, and they're not going to get it. It's dangerous, it's horrible, and it's bad for these people. And Europe has a lot of first-hand experience with this, and they're beginning to come the right direction. So, but I want to leave you on a positive note. I want to leave you on a great note, and I'm pulling this from the White House website. CEO confidence is at near record high because of Trump's war on regulation. And this is from Frank Holmes, CEO and Chief Investment Officer at U.S. Global Investors, reported at CNBC. What's nice is that the White House will repackage this so I don't have to give CNBC a click. Don't you love Trump? Confidence among chief executives at U.S.-based companies and relative to other CEOs around the world just experienced one of the largest single-quarter gains in history, up by 4.2% in the quarterly YPO Global Pulse Survey. Why? Because it's easy. By now, it's easy to just say Trump. Here's an underappreciated part of the business optimism story. Last week, President Donald Trump signed an executive order requiring that for every new federal regulation that's adopted, two old ones must be scrapped. This goes a step further than Canada's one-for-one rule implemented in 2012, that's before Trudeau. It managed to save Canadian businesses more than 22 million and 290,000 compliance hours between 2012 and 2014 alone, according to the Government of Canada. Such a rule has long been overdue in U.S. regulations, or indirect taxation, as the author calls them, which often stand in the way of growth and create economic friction. The libertarian think tank Competitive Enterprise Institute calculates that the annual cost of regulations amounts to a jaw-dropping $1.9 trillion, a figure that in 2014 exceeded $1.7 trillion collected in federal income taxes. So it really is phenomenal news. It's going to be life-changing just seeing these business executives, these people at the top of the food chain. They're going to have confidence. They're going to realize that they can hire again. They're going to realize that no longer do we have to have the 29ers and the 49ers, the 29ers meaning 29-hour per week workers, because 30 hours Obamacare kicks in, 49ers meaning companies with 49 employees because 50 Obamacare kicks in. We're going to see people hiring. We're going to see people expanding. We're going to see a renewed interest in America when it comes to the economy. It's everything Trump promised and more, and we're still not even a month into the administration. It's a great thing. All right, this has been a fantastic episode. I hope you've enjoyed it. The Honest Media, I'm Tom Papert, your host. We will be back next week. And as always, you can find me on Facebook, you can find me on Twitter, and you can watch all of our programs on YouTube. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.